registered valuer, the requirements to be a registered valuer. I'm going to record now. And then what are the code of conduct and practice that code of conduct and ethics that you need to observe to be once you have been a registered valuer. Okay, before saya start, agak-agaknya lah, Chua Kian Wan, do you want to be a registered valuer or you just want to maintain as a registered estate agent? That's not matter because kita ada tiga license.
Huh, sorry, again, doctor, not clear, not clear.
Chua?
Yes, doctor.
Do you intend to be a registered valuer?
Not intend to be a registered valuer.
Not intend, you intend. Do you want to practice as a registered valuer or you just want to focus on your estate agency? Agak-agaknya lah, since you are already in the agency, like the name with saya tanya.
Agak-agaknya, I agency.
Agency, you are not the only one, don't worry. Because we have many of your seniors, they only focus on estate agency and they are doing well. Cuma, saya nak pesan, kalau you want to be a registered estate agent in the beginning of your career, you must focus and you must maintain as a registered estate agent.
Oh,
I don't want you towards the end or towards in the middle of your career, then you realize you would like to be a registered valuer as well. As long as you don't have your own practice, then it's fine. If you are with other people, if you are not a sole proprietor, it's fine. Because if you would like to become registered valuer, or property manager, because you have the qualification to be both registered valuer and registered property manager. I don't want you to be caught eventually because of you have your sole proprietorship, then you have to domain your practice, which is not easy because at that particular time, you are already counting money, coming in, not going out.
Okay.
Right? It will be a difficult decision at that point of time if you not only to try and align juga who intend to be a registered, who intend to practice as a registered estate agent first. It's not a problem, but as long as you graduate, don't maintain to become REM, don't maintain to become PEA because you have the qualification, you have to go for the TPC, become a registered estate agent, and then practice. Boleh dengar?
Boleh.
So, because if you would like to become registered valuer, eventually you need to domain your practice. If you have a company established as a sole proprietor, that will be difficult. So, as long as it's not sole proprietorship, you can still become, because you need to go at the 2-year supervision under registered valuer. That one is a must. Okay, now we can go through the slide. Can you see my slide? Can you see the slide?
The butterfly.
Yes.
Can?
Okay.
Hello?
Yes, doctor.
Can.
Aswin, cuba you cakap kotak sikit. Macam tak cukup makan you on. Okay.
Boleh nampak, doktor?
Tak senang saya nak cakap tu.
Tapi nampak pelik tak? Saya rasa pelik tak
tu? Rasa pelik.
Tak nampak.
Sekarang nampak.
Oh, pelik. Pelik sebab jerit depan laptop.
Depan jerit depan laptop lah. Kan lagi, saya lagi teruk. I'm talking to the desktop. For nothing. Okay. Never mind. Okay, today we're going to go through the requirements to be a registered valuer and what are the code of ethics and conduct that you need to observe. I hope everybody has already got a copy of your act and rules. Ada? Semua ada?
Ada.
Ada yang belum ada? Ada yang belum ada tak? Let me know kalau ada yang belum ada. Ada? Semua dah ada. Amirul, you dah ada act and rules? Amirul Amin, do you have the act and rules with you today?
Yang saya jumpa yang akta dia. Yang rules dia tak jumpa.
Lu tak jumpa, you kena beli.
Oh.
Dalam PDF tu dia, dalam online tu dia macam tak cukup sikit, takut yang lama. You have to beli. It's about RM35. Everybody has to buy RM35. Okay, so kita go through sekarang the ethics and properly the valuers. Okay, who are the valuers? Who are the registered valuers? Agak-agaknya lah, who are the registered valuers? Kita dah go through sikit-sikit hari tu untuk your presentation of your assignment. Kalau registered valuers, siapa yang dah buat the first group? Aswin, who are the registered valuers? When you talk about register, relate back with your register. Who are the registered valuers?
Aswin. Registered valuers are those who have finished all of the examination, passed the interview and have their name registered in the registrar.
Lagi? Sudah kita dah hari tu. Register, dia ada berapa register?
Ada empat register, part 1 to part 4.
So register valuer dalam register mana?
Part 1.
Part 1, right. Yeah,
okay. So sebaiklah.
Register part 1. Okay, betul lah tu. Okay, part 1 untuk register valuer. So kalau if you can go through, the valuer's appraisal estate agent act, kita dalam act, they mention that kita ada 4 profession, valuers and appraisers, estate agents and property managers. What is the difference between valuers and appraisers? Kita dah go through hari tu. Susan.
Yes, doctor. Yes, yes.
What is the difference between valuers and appraisers?
Appraisers are those before this act is enacted and they practice the valuation, and then there is one window period they can register as the appraisers. But valuers for now is those who practice valuation after this act, and then they have to take the examination, all those examinations to be a registered valuer.
Okay, good. Very good. Okay, if you can move. So who are the registered valuer? A person whose name has been entered in the part one of the register. And once he has registered, he is also given an authority to practice issued by the board. When I say the board, it is to which board? Which board is the authority that can issue the practice as a registered valuer? Huawei. Why are you here or not?
Yes, Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah,
just now I lost.
Wow.
Yes.
Which board?
My board. What's the question? Just now I lost. I think I bought my earphone.
Okay. Which board can issue the authority to factory to the registered value? What's the name of the board?
Which board?
Board of valuers, appraisers, estate agents and property managers.
What are valuers? The S, yeah? What are valuers, appraisers, estate agents, and property managers? And the authority of practice will be issued with payment, and you have to submit with a relevant form. Okay, kita dah go through hari tu, part 1 of the register. If you can see section 14, buka section 14 under the act. Amirul, are you here? Those yang belum ada lagi complete act and rules, please jot down because nanti you cari balik. Because it's not going to be in the slide for the rule.
Yeah, yeah.
Ada pen jot down. Section 14. Section 14 of the act. Kalau buka section 14 of the act, we talk about registers. Boleh? Section 14 of the Act talk about the register, and section 14, subsection 1A, dia kata part 1 which contains the names, the business address, qualifications and other particulars of registered valuers. Okay. So it has always been the names, business address, qualifications. and other particulars of registered valuers, right? So the other tiga kat situ, your name, your business address, your qualifications and other particulars of registered valuer, right? So kalau tengok itu section 14 subsection 1 and then dia kata refer balik kepada section yang relate dengan section 14, part 5 talk about valuers and appraisers, section 17. Tujung, are you with me? Boleh?
Boleh.
Can you follow Adibah, Suraya? Boleh follow? Adibah.
Oh, boleh, boleh.
Boleh. Tadi kita section 14, section 14, subsection 1A, part A, Roman 1. Eh? And then kita move kepada section 17, which is under part 5. Adibah, you ada act and rules, eh?
Ah, ada, ada.
Ada, okay. Part 7, section 17, registration of valuers. What are the requirements to be a registered valuer? It's provided under 17, subsection 1. Kalau tengok, dia ada A sampai D, E. Boleh? Boleh nampak? Amira, can you baca? What is the first requirement to be a registered valuer? Amira?
Yeah, Dr.
First requirement to be registered valuer. Do you have the answer? Section 17, subsection 1, A, sampai D,
He has attained the age of 21 years.
Okay, he has attained the age of 21 years. Lagi tak cukup tu, tak cukup sifat tu.
And is of sound mind, good character, and has not been convicted of any offence involving fraud or dishonesty or moral turpitude during the 5 years immediately preceding the date of his application.
Okay, so within 5 years, before you reach your age of 21 years, you are actually have to observe your all those things about good character, because you must be sound mind. Sound mind means apa makna sound mind? Agak-agaknya lah. Brian Rio. Apa tu sound mind?
Sane.
Apa dia?
A sane person.
Okay, dia bukan tak betul lah, dia betul. Orang yang berfikiran waras, itu yang maksud dia in bahasa Malaysia. Sound mind, good character, and has not been convicted of any offense involving fraud. Fraud is, what is fraud? You dah belajar hari tu, what is fraud?
Penipuan.
Penipuan, or dishonesty, or moral turpitude during the 5 years immediate preceding the date of his application. So you really must observe your character 5 years before you become a registered valuer. A simple thing, kalau you involved in a road in an accident in the road and then you jadi road bully and you become viral and eventually you were given saman by the police, if it comes to the knowledge of the board, you may be TIV your application. Your application may be just step aside for a time being until the board say you are okay. Simple thing macam itu, ya. Boleh faham tak? So don't do anything, don't abuse your neighbor because your neighbor parked the car in front of your gate, you go and smash his windscreen, that's not good. Because we do have cases for an estate agent, not for the valuer, for the record, who has actually involved in this road bully. And the board comes to know about it when he wants to register. He has passed his TPC, but the person who were affected by the road bully comes to know that he is now going to submit for his registration as a registered estate agent, and he submitted together with the complaint, together with the photo that he is involved in a road bully because he smashed a window screen of the car when his car met an accident. So the board has no choice. Because under this provision, subsection 1A, the board has the reason, the board has the authority to decline your registration, right? So AA, not an undischarged bankrupt, it's not bankrupt, not made a statement or affirm or attested document that is false or misleading in a material particular. This one also, if you have were approached by anybody just to confirm certified copy Nampak true certified copy. Nampak simple eh? Betul tak Aswin? Certified true copy. Betul kan? Ambil chop saja kan? Betul Aswin?
Yeah.
Yeah. Without looking at the original copy. Especially when you want to confirm any documents that relate to an application for financial purpose or for appointment or for even as a simple a submission to obtain rumah mampu milik or submission to obtain rumah sejahtera, whatever the name is. All those requirements that you, when you do a confirmation on the document certified true copy, you must make sure it is not being amended, it is not being altered. Boleh faham? So you really must be careful when you come to that situation. And he has not dishonestly concealed material facts, not furnished false information, satisfies the requirements under section 18. Section 18 apa? Can we move section 18? Section 18, equine. Apa dia section 18? Hello, equine.
Sekejap, nak balik.
Section 18 is about what?
Section 18 is about the qualification for registration of valuer and probationary valuer.
Registration of a valuer. Sekejap, saya tak berapa dengar you all. Saya punya mark. Sekejap, Dia cakap sekarang. Can you cakap? Equine?
Section 18 is about the qualification for registration of valuer and probationary valuers.
Right. Well, qualification of a registered valuer or is the... Sebab saya tak dengar you all. You all boleh dengar saya dengan jelas eh?
Jelas.
Yes.
Okay. Right. Qualification for registration of valuers and probationary valuers. Sebabnya kalau tengok section 18, subsection 1, no person shall be registered under part 1 as a registered valuer unless he has been registered as probationary valuer under this act. Okay, probationary valuer. If you can move to probationary valuer, subsection 2, okay, boleh? Boleh? Are you here with me? Saya minta you all beli yang ini. Beli tak? Ada tak? Can you nampak tak from the record? It's a rules and guidelines to the TPC. Boleh nampak tak?
Nampak.
Boleh nampak.
For estate agency ke?
Ya. Yeah? Untuk valuer. Estate agency warna dia brown.
Tak ada, doktor tak suruh beli.
Tak suruh beli.
Kena beli dengan board kan?
Yes, kena beli dengan board. Macam mana
doktor suruh beli untuk estate agency saja.
Estate agency saja ke? Oh, nak jadi valuer dia nak jadi estate agent. Okay, never mind. Saya akan cuba macam mana nak buat eh. Somebody has to beli from KL, from KL. Kau tanya,
email kan?
Pak Ikhmal boleh ring? Pak, ya Pak Ikhmal?
Email dekat bot, nanti dia apa ni, dia postkan. Saya beli.
Ah, you pernah buat macam tu eh, email dekat bot. Okay, yeah. Tengok nama dia, rules and guidelines to the TPC, test of professional competence for registration as valuer. Boleh nampak? Saya akan snap photo and send to you all nanti. Boleh nampak dulu, but I want you to have this copy. This copy, brown untuk registered estate agent. Then we have another one, green untuk property manager. Boleh nampak? Tiga eh, Pak Ikhmal boleh nampak? Ikhwan?
Ya, yeah, boleh nampak.
Untuk estate agent sekarang warna biru.
Mana pula estate agent sekarang warna biru tu, dia punya standard ni. Dia nak yang ini. Tapi kita tengah dalam proses nak tukar. Sebab tu saya tak berapa keen nak beli.
Oh, tak payah beli lah doktor.
Lepas tu nanti nak baca kat mana? Mati. Okay, if anybody dah ada beli, beli satu kopi. Kita buat benda yang tak betul ya. Beli satu kopi and then you scan and PDF dia share. Boleh?
Boleh.
Boleh cari yang ni Pak Ikhmal?
Boleh.
You to do that. Salah, nanti cakap moral tak cucuk, tak betul.
RM5 seorang.
Doktor.
Ya.
Saya ada.
Adibah ada?
I have it from last year.
Untuk rules and guidelines for the TPC. If you have it from your senior, it's cemented sebab ni dah lama dah pun. You have it? Can you do us a favor? When I talk us, I'm referring to you all as a classmate and not to me. Walaupun benda ni saya record tak betul ni, tak buat dia. Sebab dia patut beli. Benda ni pattern nak RM10 satu baju. Okay. If you can scan, Adibar, if you can scan and then you share with your colleagues. Dia ada tak banyak pages, about 28 pages. Tapi yang belakang-belakang tu, nanti sekejap saya tengok eh. Oh, but you still need to di belakang juga. Boleh Adibar, 28 pages. You scan and then you share with your colleagues. Boleh Adibar?
Okay, sure. Boleh.
Ada estate agent ada tak? Siapa ada estate agent punya? Chua, do you have estate agent? Or Fatima ada estate agent?
I have semua, doktor.
You ada semua? Okay. You charge seorang RM3.
Okay.
You pun ada? Property manager pun ada?
Wait, property manager ada rasanya.
The TPC bukan standard is the TPC. Rules and guidelines to the TPC. Okay, if you can, you can just share dekat WhatsApp pun boleh. So saya boleh tengok whether you have the correct copy or not. Boleh Adibar? Oh, is it too heavy kalau share dekat WhatsApp? Boleh tak Faizman kalau share dekat WhatsApp? Boleh kan?
Boleh.
Faizman, boleh share dekat WhatsApp. Right, never mind.
Yeah, salah.
Okay, so we kita proceed dulu for today.
Tapi,
ada. Yeah.
Property manager tak ada. I don't have it.
Property manager tak ada. Any of your classmates yang ada property manager punya? Because property manager dia baru sikit lah. 2018. Siapa ada property manager punya? Boleh cari tak?
Tak. Tapi tak tahu lah.
Apa dia Pak Iqmal?
Sekejap, saya rasa macam saya ada yang PDF tapi tak sure.
Sekejap. Some private universities ada buat benda ni, benda yang tak betul lah.
Ada? Saya ada.
Ada? Dia ada? Okay, then just share.
Sekejap saya share.
Kita nak tiba-tiba semua orang ada benda ni. Okay, cut. Now we go to satu. Today we're going to go to the registration as evaluators. We talk about registration untuk professional evaluators tadi. There is dalam lecture nanti, dalam minggu ke, ada dia punya details dia to be a probationary member. So kita tak nak go through application for probationary members as registered untuk valuers, untuk estate agent dan untuk property managers. So kita akan go through sikit-sikit saja ya. Okay, untuk valuer, the requirement is, if you can take note, you must have 2 years continuous. This is the minimum. Continuous. You tak boleh break eh. You kena ada continuous years. Except those yang ada obtain degree abroad. Yang ni kita dah tak ada lagi dah. So it must be 2 continuous years under the supervision of a registered valuer. Kalau you rasa-rasa you buat halfway and you break and then you have to start all over again. Because the requirement is 2 continuous years. Boleh faham? Right? So it must be work, you must have the supervisor as a registered valuer. You can work in a registered valuation firm or any other establishment, not a problem. But you must inform the board and the board must have given you the approval. For example, you upon graduate, you got a job with a property developer. Is it a problem? Can you become a registered valuer? Agak-agaknya Ipuan boleh jadi registered valuer tak kalau you kerja with a private, with a developer instead of, but there is a registered, tak ada registered valuer pun. Can you work with a private, with a developer, housing developer, developer, and then you got a job, then you have to submit for the PV, boleh tak? Agak-agaknya lah. Ikhwan, mana pula dia pergi? Boleh tak agak-agaknya?
Apa dia lagi sekali?
Pertanyaan.
Gila dah sejak dulu ni.
Slide dah pergi dah. Sekejap, Ikhwan, slide saya dah pergi mana? Apa yang saya dah buat?
Dekat bawah kan? Slide.
Dekat bawah, saya tengah buka tapi dia macam tak buka. Okay, saya tanya, kalau you graduate, right? Because saya mention tadi, to be a registered valuer dalam section 18, to be a registered valuer, you must be a registered professional valuer first. Boleh dapat yang itu? Right? And for you to become a registered valuer during the period as a professional valuer, you must have the professional experience for a minimum period of 2 continuous years supervised by a registered valuer.
Maksudnya 2 tahun sebagai probationary.
Probationary tak boleh ada break. 2 tahun tak boleh ada break. Boleh? Boleh faham yang itu? Okay. Mana saya punya slide? Okay. Lepas itu, saya tanya tadi, kita punya line dekat UM ni dah tak betul. Okay, saya tanya tadi, you can work jika dalam yang ini, dalam yang ini under item number 4, requirements of professional experience. Dalam rules and guidelines to the TPC, item number 4 mention 4.01 period of experience, 2 continuous years under the registered valuer. You can either work under with a registered valuation firm or any other establishment as the board may approve. Right? And shall carry out valuation practice this supervised by registered valuer. Meaning, you boleh kerja ini in any other establishment as long as you carry out valuation practice and you are supervised by a registered valuer. Soalan saya ikhwan, once you graduate, katakanlah you dapat job with a property developer, can you submit to be a professionally valuer? Can you eventually become a professional registered valuer with your experience, with your job as a, with a property developer? Boleh tak? Agak-agaknya lah.
Rasanya tak boleh sebab dia sebab dalam probationary ni dia kena practice as a valuer lah.
Okay, so developer tak ada kerja as a valuer. PMDB dah lama dah ada valuer dekat situ. Gamuda also ada valuer. UEM also ada valuer.
Dia kena di supervised oleh registered
valuer. Kena di supervised.
Yes.
Okay. Separuh betul. Boleh. Saya suruh teka. Saya tak kata salah, saya suruh teka. Sebenarnya boleh ya. Once you graduate, you can work with any other establishment. Sebab dia cakap dekat sini, the provision under 4.01. Amirul Amin, are you here with me? Wahida, you here?
Yeah.
Okay. Under matters 4.01, item 4, in the rules and guidelines of the TPC, for the valuer dalam buku kuning ni, bukan dalam rules, tapi kita akan pergi rules nanti. It clearly mentioned that you can work with a registered valuation firm or any other establishment, right? Any other establishment must obtain the board's approval. And you must carry out valuation practice and be supervised by a registered valuer. Suppose you got a job with katakanlah tadi with a property developer and there's no valuer, there's no registered valuer in that property development company. It's fine. You can proceed to obtain yang kita panggil external supervisor. You can get the registered valuer with another firm who is practicing valuation. But he is willing to supervise you and he is willing to provide you the work experience as a valuer, professional valuer. Meaning, kalau dia boleh arrange, you work with a firm property developer, tapi kalau dalam seminggu dia bagi hari Jumaat, one day off so that you can be with the registered company, registered valuer supervise you, kita panggil external supervision. It can be done. Boleh faham?
Doctor, can you please repeat that?
Okay, what I mean is, if you work with a non-registered valuation firm, you can still submit as a professionally valuer. What needs to be done is, you must get a registered valuer who is practicing as a registered valuer to endorse as your supervisor. You must sign, you must keep supervision as a registered valuer, even though you are with other companies. So it's just like doing, kita panggil external supervision. Boleh? So it can be done because you should be able to have a, you must get some arrangement, you should have done some arrangement with the your company so that one day, out of 1 week, you are with the registered valuation firm doing valuation job. Boleh faham, Ashwin?
Faham.
Faham.
You can do it. The hard part is getting the
arrangement. Yeah, two continuous years. Kita masih acknowledge that when I say kita, I'm referring to the board. Oh, by the way, I'm no longer board member. Saya dah bagi tahu kan, saya dah habis my term. Right? So, as long as there are minimum two continuous years. Kalau tak cukup minimum two continuous years, you kerja lah. Macam tu, macam tak cukup hari, then you work for 3 years. As long as you tak ada, ada break, you inform the board. Kalau continuous years tu, memang ada kena continuous tu kena ada. The word continuous to maintain, whether 2 years, 3 years ataupun 4 years. You tak boleh ada break. Boleh faham tak? Okay, you get me? Right. So yes. For those yang jadi lecturer, they can also become a registered valuer. But then there is a requirement yang lain. Saya tak nak go through yang details yang itu sebab that will be touched when you go through the lecture untuk professionally valuers nanti. Okay, come back to this one. Kita ada payment of fee. How much is the fee? Eh? Kita belum lagi present kan fee. Fee is the group. Nanti tomorrow, besok eh, kita akan present the fee. So sekarang saya tak perlu sentuh on the fee. Kita proceed with the next slide. So what need to be fulfilled to be registered valuers? Kita dah mention tadi, registered as professional valuers a minimum of 2 continuous years. Take note on the word continuous. Eh? You kena ada continuous. Kalau ada break, then dia akan jadi masalah. Boleh faham tak? Okay, 2 continuous years. And then, dalam masa 2 continuous years, you must cover the areas of experience 3 out of 8 areas of approved professional experience. Dalam buku ni, dia ada mention appendix A. Appendix A, kita ada 8 area. Untuk kita, saya akan go to nanti. So the 8 area which we term as approved professional experience. By the way, kita masih bot dalam proses nak pindah. Saya dah, kita dah ada yang pindahan, but I cannot tell you the pindahan yet sebab belum lagi official lagi. Yeah. But as of now, kita ada 3 out of 8 areas. And if you can go through the 8 areas, these are the 8 areas. Area 1 is valuation. Landed properties, including plant and machinery and equipment, applicable relation to capital and rental values. Number 2, rating, local taxation, and then we have property management, real estate agency, compulsory land acquisition and compensation, national taxation, which refers to stamp duty, RPGT, for the income tax purpose. So this one is mainly to cater those who work with the valuation department at the federal level. And then we have property development investment, we have property consultancy and research. You choose any 3, but one of it must be valuation. Valuation is a must. Kalau tengok dekat sini ada berapa area yang untuk valuation, agak-agaknya lah. Shira, ada 8 area. Yang mana area yang memang obvious is valuation? Shira,
area 1.
Valuation.
Area 1.
Area 1, yes, correct.
Okay, taxation tu, rating and taxation.
Area 3, lagi.
Area 6. Area 5. Area 5, confirm.
Okay, lagi.
Area 8 kot.
Area 8, property development buat valuation ke?
Eh tak, saya cakap area 8.
Area 8, property consultancy buat market study ni.
Tak, tu je lah kot.
Kita ada 4 area lah, Syura.
Betul.
Area 1, area 2 rating.
Yeah.
Itu valuation.
Yeah,
kita buat lah. Kita sebut dah, okay. Area 5, compensation, definitely. And we have national taxation. Ada banyak area for valuation. So it's not a problem. So as long as you cover this, any valuation, kalau you kerja dengan property developer, definitely you tak buat national taxation, you pun mungkin tak buat compulsory land acquisition. So it's not a problem. You focus on you punya area, property development and investment. Buat property consultancy and research, because the market study, feasibility study comes under property consultancy and research. As far as kata-kata kalau kita work with the property developer. And then you just choose any other valuation with a supervisor that is also a registered valuer. So let's say the supervisor is not a big company, just a small company doing what they term as retail valuation. When they say retail valuation, it's actually valuation for financing, valuation that is more into loan from the bank, right? So definitely that will be under area one. So if you do the valuation for loan financing purpose, if you do valuation for auction purpose, comes under here, area one. So you have actually fulfilled the requirements of the three out of eight, area one, property development, and then property consultancy and research. So it's not a problem for you to be a registered valuer. Boleh? Boleh Puan? Puan boleh dengar tak? Boleh Kayun? Kayun, are you here?
Yes, doctor.
Boleh dengar? Boleh faham?
Boleh, boleh.
Ah, okay.
Doktor, dia kena fulfill berapa out of four tu?
Tiga.
Tiga.
Okay. Tiga area out of four. Boleh faham? Tiga area out of four. Okay. Apa yang you dah faham setakat ni, Nurul Aini? Nurul Aini. Apa yang you dah faham? Yes. Tiga dari empat itu dalam slide. Kita ada lapan area, kita tak sebut slide. Kita cakap tadi kita ada tiga daripada lapan. Ini yang lapan kita buat ni. Mula-mula sekali kena jadi apa nak jadi registered valuer. First step is to be a first step nak jadi apa. Sebelum boleh sampai ke sini, first step, langkah pertama, what must be done once you graduate? And here you have your scroll. Kena jadi apa? What must be done? First step, anybody? Susan? New?
Yes.
First step, once you graduate, once you have your degree scroll, bukan di graduate saja yang kena ada scroll eh?
Yeah, so first we step, have to register with the board to become professionally valuer.
Valuer, yes, that's the first step. First step, once you got the job, once you dah dapat your score, register with the board to be a PV, because the PV is a must. Sama juga kalau nak jadi estate agent, PEA is a must. Kalau PV for 2 years, kalau you ada degree, nak jadi PEA is only for 1 year. Right? Okay, memang yang PEA tu, kita focus on PV today. So, PV 2 years continuous year. It must be under the supervision of a registered valuer and it can be any other, any establishment or with the registered valuation firm. Right? So you can, once you have gone through, once you have become a PV, then you need to go through the working experience, areas of experience 3 out of 8. So saya dah bagi 3 out of 8, one of it must be valuation. So under valuation, you can choose from the 4 areas. Boleh aja with me Nurul Aini? Nurul Aini, and then you ada yang lain. Okay, so kita dah boleh dapatkan the 2 years under 3 areas. Because you can know, if you can go back, kita ada work diary and logbook. This must be done also, work diary and logbook. I don't have the work diary for valuation. Okay, work diary and logbook. And then kita ada record of experience, the ROE, record of experience is just a simple, like a simple report, not that many, it's about 15 pages, 10 pages paling banyak. Record of experience is during that 2 years, apa yang you dah buat, completed your job, because this is the requirement dalam buku sini, ya. Nanti bila dah go through dalam PV, you akan go through. And kita ada 2 practical tasks under task part A, ya. 2 practical tasks, kalau kita go through dekat sini, the one is also under the PV. Saya tak nak mention dekat sini, but we have 2 practical tasks. Kalau tengok dalam here, dalam appendix B. there. Appendix B. Yes.
Apa beza work diary dengan logbook? Sebab dekat page bot ni dia ada jual buku work diary and logbook untuk probationary valuer, tapi untuk estate agent probationary dia just jual buku work diary.
Work diary saja. Okey, saya cuma ada contoh sekejap saya ambil contoh. Oh, I have lah. Saya akan diberi kerja untuk assess FOC. Ini nama dia, work diary logbook. Boleh nampak? Boleh nampak Afiq?
Boleh.
Boleh. Okey, kena nampak eh. Work diary and logbook. Beza dia, kalau untuk valuers warna kuning, kalau untuk estate agent warna brown. Estate agent dia cuma tulis work diary saja. Saya tak ada copy kalau kita dah pulangkan balik. Kalau saya jumpa copy, saya akan set gambar bagi dia. Okey, so dalam dekat sini, work diary and logbook, kalau untuk valuers, kita akan ada dia panggil work diary benda dekat depan dekat sini. Are you with me? Right? Actually benda yang sama saja. Work diary and logbook, what you need to be done is just you have to fill in macam you fill in dalam you punya diary lah. Hari ni buat apa, hari ni buat apa, hari ni buat apa. Okay. Ini dia panggil logbook. This part is logbook. Yang depan ni work diary. Okay. So dekat logbook, kita ada values. Untuk valuers, dia ada analysis of diary sheet. Boleh nampak tak?
Yes.
Boleh. Yes. Eh? Analysis of diary sheet is just ini yang selalu orang buat salah. Okay, kita ada 1 sampai 12 bulan and then kita ada 12 sampai 24 bulan. Satu bulan dia ada berapa area, 8 area ni. You just letak bulan pertama ada berapa kali yang you buat kerja berkaitan dengan valuation yang katakanlah untuk area 1 tadi. Bulan pertama, valuation of landed property. So you kata bulan pertama you buat like 4 kali ataupun you buat seminggu ada 5 job. So 5 kali 4, 20. Okay. Satu bulan ada berapa hari? Satu bulan berapa working days?
20 days.
20. Working days lah. Asking.
Working days, 5 days a week, 4 weeks, 20 lah. 20 to 24 I guess.
Mana boleh 2024? Satu bulan ada berapa hari?
30, tapi working days tak termasuk.
Kan jadi 20 hari. Lebih lah.
Saturday Sunday. Saturday Sunday.
Kalau 20 hari tak cukup sifat nanti kan?
Okay.
20 hari baru satu kali. Tak cukup. Satu bulan ada 31 hari. 30 hari ya. So maximum okay. Satu bulan ada 25 ataupun 26 working days. Okay. So make sure dalam dekat sini yang you tulis nombor yang 1, 2, 3 bulan tu jangan lebih daripada 25. Effectively working days is 25 days. Kita kira dalam satu bulan ada 30 hari, dia ada mungkin maksimum 25 days. So jangan pergi salah kira dekat sini. Make sure the supervisor sign dekat bawah sini. So ada banyak case dia tak buat. Ah, ini dia tak buat ni. Saya akan reject yang ini. Dia tak kira.
Apa itu?
Ah, so kalau macam ini saya kata this work diary is incomplete. So saya ambil yang lain lagi. Ini yang saya akan assess. Okay, kalau tengok yang ini. Ah, ni yang dia buat. Betul tak? Ah, more or less betul. Nampak? The first year dia ada row dekat sini. This is the first year 12 hari, ni this is second year.
Tak nampak dah macam atas sikit?
Ya, dah kekrit. Nampak it up a bit.
Ah, okay. Atas sikit. Ah, yes.
Saya tak nampak, saya tunjuk je. Boleh okay. Nampak?
Nampak yeah. Nombor. Okay.
Nampak nombor? Dekat lagi, ha?
Okay, kira saya.
Clear dah?
Ada.
Okay. So, kalau tengok hari dia, kalau tengok dekat sini, dalam kat sini, dia ada 150, 25, 53. Boleh nampak tak? 150, 25, 53. Total dekat tepi sini. Boleh nampak lah, Binia?
Nampak.
Nampak eh? You can see 150, 25, 53. This is considered as not balanced. Because you need to have a balance of, kalau kata kat sini 80. Dia ada berapa? 150 jadi is about 220. Bagi 3. 220, kata 221 bagi 3. About 70. This is just very glaring 150. Very much focused on valuation saja. Could be from the valuation firm. Yeah, he is with the Jones and Witten. So kalau macam gini, saya akan approve ataupun saya akan nakal sikit, saya kata extend another 2 months sebab you need to have a balance of your areas of professional experience. Boleh faham? To make sure bila kerja bagi tahu boss, you need to fill in the logbook, you need to have a balance areas of professional experience. The boss will understand. The boss akan allocate you. But kalau macam gini, dia letak real estate agency. But estate agency ada 25 tadi. So make sure bila year 2, dia boleh cover jadikan balance. Sebab kalau tidak, kita akan extend. Saya selalunya akan bagi it within sampai 6 months. Kalau nampak balance yang tak balance sangat, saya akan cakap extend or penalty of another 3 months to ensure area of key is given a focus. Not only ambil area 1 sahaja. Boleh faham? Okay. So this are the word dari. So kalau tengok apa contoh yang dia tulis adalah word dari. Boleh nampak? Dia nampak tak? Labimya, can you see contoh?
Yeah, yeah, I can.
Shira, boleh nampak?
Boleh, boleh. Tapi boleh. Tak boleh baca. Terbalik.
Terbalik. Tak apalah. Saya bacakan. Okay?
Okay.
Kalau tengok, finalize and send both soft copies, hard copies of the full valuation report, update letter for the 49 story purpose bill office and report under valuation. So more or less, dia betul lah. Sebab as an assessor, kita akan baca every single word yang dia tulis kat sini because we don't want you to cheat. And we really want you to be betul. Yang dia tulis tu kalau tengok area dia, dekat tepi sini, kita ada area of the code. Yang ada code tu kan dekat tepi sini. Dia nampak? Itu dia
nampak. Nampak, ha? Nampak, doktor.
Okay, kita ada area 1, area 2, area 3 kan? So kat sini cuma dia ada juga area 8 kat sini. Boleh nampak tak?
Ada 9 sekali dia tu. 9 apa pula?
Ya, bagus.
Macam mana 9 sini? Faham?
That's 89. What's 89? That's number 9 dia.
Number 9? Mana ada number 9? Ada number 8.9 lah.
Oh, 0.9.
8.9. Sebab area 8 dia ada 8.1, 0.2, 0.3,
0.4. Ah, okay. Yeah.
Okay. Right? So okay, so basically inilah contoh dia. Saya akan cuba screenshot and share dengan you only. Okay, if you can move, kita dah pukul 11. Right, so kita dah go through tadi the logbook and word diary, practical task, is under, nanti akan go through dengan Dr. Zaf. And then kita ada PPC, ada 4 area, valuation, property law, taxation, property management, development and investment and also estate agency. 4 area, 1 area setengah jam, 30 minit campur dengan 2 practical task kalau buat 2 years ataupun 3 years ataupun 4 years, tak cukup 10 tahun. Kita ada 1 jam, 2 jam, 3 jam for the first timer. Boleh? Boleh ready?
Right. Doctor.
Yes.
Just now doctor mentioned about the appendix. Which book does the appendix in the appendix located?
The appendix dalam buku ni. Dalam test of professional competence, the guideline.
Alright, doctor.
In the guideline. Yang tadi, Shira, siapa cakap tadi?
Adibah
cakap. Adibah Suraya kata dia boleh share dengan you all. Saya cakap tak, saya cakap charge 5 minit korang. Okay, boleh?
Boleh.
Right. Can we move? Section 19, we talk about valuation practice. So what is the valuation practice as a registered valuer? If you can move to section 19 of the Act, clearly mentioned section 19 kita ada A, B, C. C kita dah buang, dah delete. So A is the valuation of all lands and buildings and all interests termasuk dengan trees, crops, furniture, fixtures, fittings, semua sekali. Intangible and also tangible. And B, valuation of lands and buildings and all interests required for feasibility study is also part of the valuation practice. Project management also is deemed part of the project valuation practice, but it is not just project management, it's actually the valuation for project management. Boleh faham? the valuation for court proceedings, the valuation for arbitrations or any other purpose, as long as you do valuation of lands and buildings, not limited to just number one, number two also termasuk dalam kategori valuation practice. Boleh? Ada soalan setakat ni? Any more? Kita baru slide number
one.
Yes. Okay. So if you can, how to practice? You can practice as a sole proprietor. Kita ada dalam firm tadi kan? Siapa group yang buat masa firm hari tu? Oh, belum lagi. Okay, to practice as a valuer, you need to have a firm. You cannot practice on your own as an individual. So practice by firms ada dalam section 23. Sekejap, saya tengah cari satu. Dalam section 23, okay, kita akan go through dalam firm dalam dia punya minggu ke-12. Dr. Zaf akan go through to practice as a firm. So I'm not going to go through into detail, but in general, when we talk about firm, section 23, kita ada empat jenis firm yang you boleh practice. First is a sole proprietor of a sole proprietorship, which means you are alone as a director or managing director or as a principal. And then you have a company which is called a partnership. You can have two partners, you can have many, many partners. And it can also be a shareholder or a director of a body corporate. In a company, in a, this is a company which is a limited, no, sendirian berhad. Right? So in this one, you register with ROC. You need to register with registrar of company. And then the first is ROB, registrar of business. But you don't really need to register ROB because you need to register with the board. Right? The ROC is a must, I think, ROC, but at the same time, you need to have the register with the board of the company. The board will give an approval whether your proposed company will be approved or not. Agak-agaknya lah. Aswin, company you nanti kalau ada nak bagi nama apa agak-agaknya Aswin?
Tak tahu lah doktor, tiba-tiba tanya macam ni, kena fikir lama-lama.
Ya lah, nak bagi nama company apa? What's the name of the company? Kalau kata you nak buat as a partners lah ataupun as a sole proprietor.
Okay, handsome.
Ha, apa dia asyik?
Tak nak buat dia.
Sebab cakap, sebab bukan nama semua nama company boleh dapat kelulusan daripada
buat. Oh, okay, okay. Kalau macam tu, if that's the reason why you're asking, maybe how about Empire Corp? Empire Corp Sendirian Berhad.
Is there Empire Corp as far as the property development is concerned outside? Because if it has, kalau dapat Empire Corp, unless you have Empire Corp Property Services, then dia jadi lain. Kalau dah ada nama tu dekat luar, then it will not resemble as a company of a real estate company. You will be asked to change the name so that it becomes to portray a registered valuation or a registered property company. Do you faham?
Understood.
And then you cannot have a name of the company that become kita panggil Lauditory. Lauditory is kind of like you semua. The nama you company, katakanlah Best Valuation, Best Aswin Valuation, Best Aswin Realty. The word best to may attract as Lauditory. So yang itu juga tidak boleh di... luluskan. Dan bot takkan luluskan. Is this one. Boleh faham yang itu ya? Eh? So to practice, not necessarily work as a principal or as the boss. You can also work, registered with the board or work as an employee of the above one, two, three. So this is how you should practice. It's either you work with them as a registered valuer or you have your own establishment. One, if you want to have your own establishment, the establishment can be in the manner of sole proprietor, proprietorship, or a partnership, or it can become a body corporate, which is a company. Ada tiga choice for you to practice as a firm, or you can also work as an employee of the firm. One, two, three. Boleh faham?
Doctor, what are the examples of name that was rejected before?
Okay, the name of the rejected before, kalau kita kata, dia kata, siap saya ingat, apa nama company kena reject tu? dia bagi term yang dia kata something like the best, the value chef, oh dia panggil champion real estate. Champion real estate, champion realty, champion nama dia. Katalah champion Aswin Realty. So the word champion tu is considered as laudatory. Itu kita akan bijak. The word champion tu, kita tak boleh cakap you are the best, you are the most, semua yang the best and the most tu semua tak boleh. Okay.
Doctor, is considered what? What's that word is it?
Laudatory. L-A-U-D, laudatory. Laudatory, T-O-R-Y, laudatory. Kita akan go through nanti dalam kita punya rules ada dalam kat sini. Okay. So itu untuk the valuation registered with the board. And kalau tengok dekat dalam rules, okay, you here with me on the rules. Untuk authority to practice, ni how to practice, authority to practice. Kita ada dalam rules 22, eh, special authority to practice juga ada. You here with me? Untuk special practice, kita ada practice as a normal practice as per the section 19 tadi. Are you here with me? And then kita ada special authority to practice valuation. Right? So itu dalam rules 22. Are you here with me? Rules 22.
Yes.
Sebab kita ada berkait dengan, are you here with me?
Yes.
Yes, doctor.
Form C. Second schedule. Siapa yang tak ada tulis, yang nanti pergi cari balik ya. Right? Yang itu untuk special authority to practice valuation under section 22 of the Act shall apply to the registrar. So we can move back section 22 of the Act. Itu tadi dalam rules ya. Eh? Dalam rules 22. Go back to section 22 of the Act. Section 22 of the Act untuk valuation. Are you here with me?
Yes. Yeah.
Section 22 talk about 22A is registration of estate agent, and then 22B talk about B, C, G, F sampai habis semua 22. 22 is practically for registered estate agent and registered property manager. Boleh faham? Right? So those yang nak dapat special authority to practice valuation under section 22 of the Act can apply in Form C in the second schedule. Dia practice an estate agent, dia practice as a registered property manager. Okay. Tapi dia domain practice dia as a registered valuer because he only want, like for example, he only want to focus on, he has all the license, but at that particular time, he only activate his estate agency license. And then, if you want to practice also as a valuer, he can submit for special authority to practice. Because he has the qualification, he has the license, but when he register, he only wants to focus on estate agent or property managers only. Boleh faham? Boleh faham tak? So he can actually submit to practice the registered as a registered valuer, but he has to go through under the form. But ada case-case yang macam itu. Bila dia nak buat special property valuation, let's say untuk estate agent, eh, when the bank ataupun when the company appoint him to do estate agency or to sell property, any other property owner appoint him to sell their property as an estate agent, but at the same time the property owners would like to appoint him to also produce a valuation report. Because he is registered valuer. Sepatutnya dia tak boleh. But he can do that under a different company. So that's the reason why dia bagi section 22 special authority to practice valuation. Boleh faham? Boleh faham?
Tak.
Okay. He can move. So what are the duties of the valuers? Ini dalam kita punya Code of Ethics and Conduct. What are the duties? Kita tengok dalam rules. Are you with me? Masih lagi okay ke? Dah nak kena break ke? Do you need a break?
Tak ada time, but the previous slide. On the previous slide, for special authority, Is there any conditions or certain criteria that the corporate, the firm needs to abide to before getting the authorization?
Ada. So, saya tak highlight yang itu sebab ini jarang-jarang berlaku. Okay, tapi apa yang disebutnya, kalau tengok dalam section dalam rules 22, dia ada rules 22.1 sampai 7, panjang rules dia. So they mention about 22.1, every person desirous of obtaining special to practice shall apply in Form C in the second schedule. Kalau tengok second schedule, if you can move to second schedule, dia ada Form C dekat situ. Are you with me? Your second schedule is under, I'm not sure dalam you punya copy page berapa, tapi dalam saya punya copy is page. Dari lepas Form B1 tu, kita ada Form C. An application for special authority to practice as a valuer. Dia ada kat dalam situ, the requirement is I, the undersigned, apply for a special authority to practice as a valuer for a period of not exceeding 180 days in any calendar year. Dia ada limited, dia ada limit dekat situ. Satu tahun ada berapa hari Aswin? Aswin, satu tahun ada berapa hari?
Kamu ingat ke?
Satu tahun ada berapa hari?
365.
365.
66 kalau leap year.
Yelah, now dia pandai buat jawab dia leap year pula. Jadi satu bulan dia cukup 20 hari je. Okay. Now, the requirement untuk special practice, kalau tengok dalam Form C, dia ada application for special authority to practice as a valuer. And the period to practice as a special authority to as a valuer ni, because you are an estate agent, you are also a property manager. You boleh apply without you register as a company yang ada V kat depan tu. A company you tak ada V. Tapi you are registered valuer, you boleh practice as a valuer. But then you tak practice sebab your company tak ada the license V untuk as a valuation company. Boleh faham tak apa yang saya nak cakap ni?
Faham.
The period given is not to exceed 180 days in any one calendar year. Right? So, satu tahun tak boleh lebih daripada 180 days daripada 365. It's almost like 6 months macam itu. And the requirement yang lain is just declaration by an employer. You nak pergi attached to which company yang you nak practice untuk special authority to practice. Kena ada confirmation daripada company yang nak bagi you consent to practice as a valuer. Boleh faham? Attachment. This is like attachment.
Understood.
Okay, tenang saja.
Doctor, can a person work under government?
Can a person work under? Tak dengar.
Government.
Boleh, yes. You mean government macam mana? With other, which government are you referring to? Which department are you referring to specifically?
I think GPPH.
Oh, GPPH, of course GPPH can become a registered valuer even though they are merely doing registered, doing valuation saja. Kalau tengok dekat sini, okay, can go back. Kalau tengok GPPH, they only do valuation part 1 and they also have valuation untuk land acquisition and they also have national taxation, stamp duty and semua. Probably they have a bit on the property consultancy, but in general they only have 3 areas. Valuation, landed properties, and then valuation untuk stamp duty, and then valuation untuk rating kalau ada, ataupun valuation untuk land acquisition and compensation. They don't do much, they don't do estate agency, they don't do property management, hardly do listing, and hardly do property investment. Because the requirement is tadi, to be a registered valuer, you must do either 3 of this area, but one must be valuation. So if they do all valuation, it's fine. So the tricky part is when they come for the interviews, because when come for the interviews, there will be 4 areas. There will be 4 areas of the interview, which is valuation, property law and taxation. This one is not a problem because this is law. And then you have property development, management and investment, which they don't cover this one, and they don't also cover estate agency. It's still okay because there are a lot of classes out there and you still have to read on your own because you need to familiarize yourself with all the standards. So the standards tadi kan? Standards yang warna biru kata Pak Ikmal tadi untuk estate agent yang ini. Malaysian Estate Agency Standard. Betul Pak Ikmal? You ada betul yang ni ya? Kalau yang ni ya?
Betul, doktor. Betul.
Ah, yang kita ada yang ini. Sejauh. standard. And kita ada the valuation MDS. Yang ini pun kadang-kadang dia tak lepas. Dia buat valuation yang ini dia pun dia tak hafal. So not necessary those from JPPA, they are master. It depends on the individual. You really need to do your homework. When you find the course of professional competence, you must be professional competence. You must be able to show your confidence because you are no longer a student. Kalau you hafal, soalan kita mungkin tricky. For example, kalau kata property law, saya akan tanya soalan, a simple soalan lah pada saya simple. But I'm very, I know I'm, for me, many of the candidates out there always tell me as panel TPC yang kalau nama doktoran dia boleh tukar orang lain tak? Dia garang cakap. Tapi dia tak tahu passing rate dengan doktoran yang paling tinggi compared to other panel. Okay, property law. Saya tanya soalan, kita ada berapa jenis title as far as our national land code is concerned? Pak Iqmal, jawab berapa jenis title yang kita ada?
Dua, doktor.
Apa dia?
Enam. Data title.
National land code, tutup juga.
Lupa.
Baru belajar last semester. Nah, last year. Siapa nak boleh jawab? Aswin nak cuba jawab, berapa jenis title yang kita ada? How many types? What are the types of title that is provided under the National Land Code?
Jangan tanya lagi tandas.
Pandai lah you Alta. Okay. Five. Sui Jo, how many types of title ada? Sui Jo.
Not sure.
Dua, doktor. Dua.
Macam mana ni dah belajar, dah lupa. Belajar dengan saya pula tu, saya ajar ke masa tu?
Dua, doktor. Enam.
Dua. Apa dia? Saya cakap qualified dua, betul tak?
Final title.
Qualified title. Qualified dengan final title. Apa beza qualified title dengan final title?
Qualified title, length tu dia belum.
Belum apa?
Dia belum bau.
Belum dia ukur halus. Jupem.
Siapa yang ukur halus?
Land surveying. Land surveyor.
Which land surveyor?
Ya.
Itulah cara saya tanya soalannya. Sebab you jawab tak cukup habis. Which land surveyor, Ikhwan? Siapa yang confirmkan dia akan jadi final title?
Land
registered
surveyor. Land surveyor.
Which land surveyor? Any land surveyor?
No.
No. Then?
Registered land surveyor?
Which register? Kita ada registered land surveyor ke? Land surveyor the only profession yang dalam kita punya bidang yang tak panggil registered. Dia panggil diri dia license land surveyor. Dia tak panggil
license land surveyor.
Which license land surveyor, Fawaz?
Appointed by the PTG.
Appointed by PTG? I ketuk juga.
I
thought
you had the
term. Jupam, is it?
Jupam.
Only Jupam can confirm title you jadi qualified atau jadi final. Kau hati je. Bukan saya yang ajar hari tu ke? Kau yang belajar
nasi. Tak ajar.
Ya? Atau Dr. Has yang ajar yang ni?
Doktor, aku kan.
Lepas tu? Penat je saya explain dulu.
Banyak makan semut, doktor.
Okay, kita habis lagi soalan title tu. Kita ada juga title yang pegang di bawah land office title. Lagi satu, title apa?
PTD. Title.
Satu land office title, lagi satu. Cepatlah jawab, Ikhwan.
Pejabat Tanah Daerah.
Ikhwan. Apa satu tadi?
Pejabat Tanah Daerah. PTD.
Satu land office title. PTG. Satu PTG. Alia, PTG tu orang panggil title apa?
Registry title.
Suka-suka hati dia registrar. Registry title. Okay. Apa beza registry title dengan land office title? Kita buat TPC hari ni.
Land more than 10 acre.
land man, more than 10 acres. Jadi, itu je.
Tak ingat.
Tak ingat? Ha. Okay, katakanlah saya ada tanah satu bidang dekat Mungkin Dengkil. Okay, Mungkin Dengkil, tanah saya 12 acre. Mungkin Dengkil dekat Sepang. If I were to do a title search, I will ask my title search boy to go to where? Which office? Is it pejabat tanah dan daerah Sepang?
Daerah.
Atau mana? Kat mana Syirah?
Pejabat tanah daerah.
Pejabat tanah daerah. 12 acres ya?
Oh, ini yang 12 acres eh?
Ha. 12 acres pergi mana? Dekat Sepang. Office mana? Ikuan?
Dekat Shah Alam.
Shah Alam ya? Because dia kena pergi registry title. More all the land, country land, more than 10 acres akan pergi kepada registry title. Katakanlah saya ada tanah 2 ekar dekat Shah Alam. Dan dekat section 2 Shah Alam. Saya nak pergi buat title search dekat mana?
Pejabat tanah. Pejabat tanah daerah.
Pejabat tanah dan daerah Shah Alam eh?
mana ada Syairah PT?
Dekat Shah Alam tu jugalah.
Kenapa dekat Shah Alam? Pejabat apa?
Pejabat tanah daerah.
Shah Alam bukan bawah anda petaling ke doktor?
PDG.
Apa nak pergi pejabat tanah ni? Saya ada 2 ekor tanah dekat section 2 Shah Alam eh. Section 2. Tengah bandar Shah Alam. Tengah bandar raya Shah Alam. Bawah majlis Shah Alam apa benda ya? Bandar raya. Bukan ni. Perbandaran ni. Saya pergi buat title search dekat mana? Memang sesat lah you all ni. Hai Kuan. Kuan.
Dekat Shah Alam tu jugalah sebab dia under Shah Alam, daerah dia under Shah Alam juga. Daerah ke?
Ada ke pejabat tanah Shah Alam ni?
Tak ada.
Tak ada?
PTG.
Kenapa PTG?
Pejabat tanah.
Tanah dan galian.
Pejabat tanah dan galian. Kenapa kena pergi kat PTG? Kenapa tak boleh pergi kat pejabat tanah petaling tu?
Sebab.
Sebab?
Sebab dia dekat Shah Alam.
Sebab more than 10 acres.
Tak, dia
2 acres. Sebab
more than
10 acres?
Tak, dia
2 acres. Saya bagi yang 2 acres sekarang. 2 acres dekat section 2.
2 acres ni.
Ha, 2 acres. 2 acres tadi.
Pejabat daerah petaling ada ke?
Kenapa Ikhwan?
Petaling ada PTG ke? Tak ada PTD.
Satu negeri ada berapa PTG?
Oh, dia ikut daerah kan. Satu negeri satu lah PTG.
Satu PTG saja. Macam mana nak jawab law macam kita punya lama? Baru soalan law, belum lagi property taxation. Sebab tu saya boleh jawab semua soalan kalau orang tanya. Sebab saya biasa tanya semua-semua ni. It covers all the profession. Okay, in general, kalau tanah bandar, tanah pekan, tanah bandar, tanah pekan, dia kata semua tanah bandar dan tanah pekan, dia tak kira berapa luas dia, dia cuma ada 1,600 kaki persegi pun, kalau dia duduk dalam tanah bandar dan pekan, title search is done at registry office. Lupa dah. Dia akan jadi title HSD sebab dia duduk dalam tanah dalam kawasan bandar ataupun pekan. Right? Town and village pekan. Kalau untuk Ikhwan, bandar katakanlah dekat Kuala Berang. Dia rasa Kuala Berang tu bandar ke tak? Dalam pusat bandar itself eh. Kalau dia dalam pusat bandar, even dia dekat Pekan Ajil. Kita Pekan Ajil, saya cakap Ikhwan sebab saya nak refer bandar yang kecil ya. Pekan Ajil, very small. Even kalau dekat sini pun, kita ada Pekan Dengkil. Pernah pergi Pekan Dengkil pun tak pernah pergi. Sui Jong, you duduk mana Sui Jong?
Kulai, Johor.
Kulai. Okay. Kulai is bandar Kulai. Apa pekan yang kecil dekat Kulai? Kata kalau dekat Johor, Kudai tak bukan besar. Okay. Kulai. Kulai is it's not a city as per the city of Johor Bahru or even a smaller than even smaller. Tangkak dengan Kulai mana lagi besar? Tangkak lagi besar kan, Sui Jong?
Ya, rasanya.
Tangkak.
So, Kulai is a small town. But any properties, any lot that is located within the boundary of bandar, bukan bandar, dia panggil Pekan Kulai. The title says cannot be done in land office dekat Kulai. Ada land office tak dekat Kulai? Ada kan?
Ada.
Saya nak jawab ada pun takut. Ada tak? Saya tak tahulah ada ke tak ada ni. You have one. Jabat Tanah Kulai eh. Jabat Tanah dan Daerah Kulai. But you don't do your title search in Jabat Tanah dan Daerah dekat Kulai because you have the title will be kept at the registry office, which is at dekat mana kalau Johor? Is it at the Johor Bahru? Atau?
Nusa Jaya.
Nusa Jaya. Johor is the only registry office yang tidak berada di ibu negeri sebab dia telah pindah ke Nusa Jaya. Yep. Dulu dia tak Bukit Timbalan tu. So dekat Johor Bahru. Now dia dah move to Nusa Jaya. The rest in the country, semua PTG berada di ibu negeri masing-masing. Satu PTG, satu negeri, satu PTG sahaja. Semua tanah, bandar dan pekan, you have to do your title search at the PTG. Other than that, if you have country land, more than 10 acres, you still have to go back to the registry office. So in this case, I've given you tadi untuk law, two types of titles. We have qualified titles, we have final titles. Qualified becomes a final title when it has been final surveyed by Japan. Japan is the director of survey department of Malaysia. And then kita ada dua jenis lagi. Kita ada one is a land office title, the other one is registry office title. Registry office title is for those properties located within the boundary of city or village ataupun pekan, and also all country land more than 10 acres. Boleh faham? Okay. So country land less than 10 acres, you have to do the title search dekat mana Shira? Shira.
Ya, dekat PTG, more than 10 acres kan?
Less than 10 acres.
Oh, dekat Pejabat Tanah Daerah.
Okay, Pejabat Tanah Daerah. Okey dah, kita reverse balik. Itulah dia. Kalau kata, kalau Valuation Department tadi, siapa yang tanya tadi, maknanya dia boleh. So, maknanya they have to read on their own, they have to attend the class, they have to really go through the question, the answer to the property management, on the estate agency, even though they don't practice that in their course of working because they are attached with the government department valuation firm, right? So we have a lot of valuers, registered valuers in the valuation department. Because kalau nak naik pangkat, if you want to go become, if you be a registered valuer, then you boleh naik pangkat tu. Kita panggil when you start your first job, you will be W41, and then you akan jadi senior, which is kanan, pegawai kanan, is W44 or 45. Ataupun dia naik jadi W48. 48 means you dah jadi registered valuer. Lepas tu baru you naik jadi timbalan W52 and then you jadi Dusa 54 or general. But if you're a lecturer, you have to do your PhD, you straight away become DS52. You lompat straight away. So the gaji is not the same, but you have to work hard. You have to go to the miserable life as a PhD student lah, macam gitu. Okay, can we move?
Doctor, like
yes, yo. Tell you.
Doctor, like the private firm, how they going practice in taxation, the rating?
Private firm, okay. If you are private firm, normally what they do is they do the valuation. Sebab tu saya tunjuk tadi, heavily focus on the valuation tadi. Masih ingat tadi? Yang kita dah saya bagi tadi? Dia punya yang dia calculate, dia punya diary sheet tadi, analysis of diary sheet. Korang ni tak calculate, dia kena reject nanti. Yang ini dia calculate tadi, dia kata tak balance kan. Saya tunjuk tadi dia tak balance. Yang ini masih ingat lagi. So, this is from the valuation firm. Boleh? Yo?
Boleh, boleh.
Okay, this is from the valuation firm. Yang tadi pun from the valuation firm. So they are from the valuation firm. So maknanya in most cases heavily focus on area one. Okay, they do estate agency and they do also property management. In this case, this person do consultancy. This one maybe he's kalau tengok yang ini, dia buat boleh nampak tak? Boleh nampak yang tadi? dia buat property consultancy, dia buat feasibility study, and also dia juga dia buat market study and they do real estate agency. Because most valuation firm, they don't only do valuation, dia ada dua. At least dia ada dua, estate agency or dia buat juga property management. And property consultancy is part of the research. Okay, so it's not a problem. You will cover. But as long as you make sure, kalau lebih tak cukup, then you have to highlight to the boss that boss biasanya akan bagi undertaking. Kita akan minta nanti that they will expose these three to at least the three areas out of eight areas. Boleh? Yo?
Okay.
Boleh?
Boleh.
Okay, not a problem. Okay, and can I move? That's blasting. Okay, what are the duties of the valuer? Is this is under the duties of the valuer, you must provide services absolute fidelity, loyalty to duties and organization, true and honest, uphold the interest of the dignity, practice his profession with devotion, ada semua kat situ, honor, integrity, courtesy and loyalty to his country, and in a spirit of fairness, this is very important, in a spirit of fairness and goodwill to his fellow valuers, employees and subordinates. You don't do the job that will jeopardize your companies, the other companies, your competitors. Itu yang you can observe. So if you can go through dalam kita punya rules, kita ada code of conduct untuk valuers, part 9. Boleh? Part 9, rule 62. Boleh? Part 9, rule 62. Are you with me? Ada Alia? Alia, Alia, ada?
Ya.
Yeah, yeah. Ah, dapat part 9, rule 62.
Service.
Yes, under service, it is to render service with absolute fidelity, saya dah bagi kat atas tu tadi. And the spirit of fairness, this is actually dalam saya punya slide number 9, this is rules 62. Right? Oh, apa dia sudah buat? Sekejap.
Oh, ada tadi dekat text box yang atas.
Oh, saya salah pergi. Okay, duties and apa tu, loyalties to duties, aku tak boleh dah hilang dah dia punya ni. Devotion is it? And organization loyalty to duties, dah hilang dia punya ni. Sekejap. Oh, to duties and organization. Itulah. Organization, truth. Okay, truth and honesty. Okay, dah. Right, truth and honesty and uphold the interest. Okay, these are the duties untuk the valuers. Practically, this is actually under dalam kita punya rules. Berapa tadi? 62. Right, so this is under rule 62. We all can go to. Then kita ada rule 63. We talk about conduct of the valuer and as the agent. Right, so shall hold all professional matters confidential until released by the client or until the work of report in the case of transaction and person has left or completed. So they must have the confidentiality. Kalau katakanlah you value for your clients for sale purpose, you value 6 million or you value 16 million. You cannot release that figure to the prospective buyer because you are appointed by the landlord or by the owner to determine the value for sale purpose. It's up to him, but you cannot release to the prospective buyer. Boleh faham? Itulah maksud dia case ini. Ataupun kalau case-case untuk court proceeding, katakanlah you value untuk the purpose is for claim. For claim purpose dalam case-case divorce, dalam case matrimony. Okay? So you cannot reveal to the husband or you cannot reveal to the other half. This is the amount of the property that you want to claim. even though you know both parties. You cannot release the information. You must uphold your professionalism to the person who appoints you to do the valuation. You cannot release for any other to any other party, right? And you charge to client Share Compass only remuneration in connection with his work study. Ini yang kita punya fees. Your friend akan present besok on fees. Mana dia siapa yang akan present besok? Scale of fee, Amira, Wahida dengan Lamia besok on fees. Right? And you will not render service if his job professional knowledge is insufficient to undertake the job. Kalau you don't know the property, katakanlah you, because when you do valuation, it's not limited to just the, kita ada limitation to the when you register dekat Johor, can you do the valuation job untuk Penang? Agak-agaknya lah. Can you do the valuation job in Penang if your company is based in Johor? Agak-agaknya lah.
Can.
Boleh tak? Yo.
Yes, can, but for appraiser cannot.
Okay, sebab kita tak limit eh. But if you are not sure about the Penang punya market, don't take up the job. As simple as that. Like your branch Penang yang buat macam gitu. Sebab tu dia company dia ada branch. Dia tak cover semua. Tapi ada company yang tak ada branch, dia boleh buat. But if you don't have a limited knowledge, it means you don't have sufficient evidence to support your, because dia kata sini, professional knowledge. Professional knowledge, because you have your knowledge as a valuer. But if you don't know the property market in a particular area, don't take up the job. If you don't have enough evidence, you don't take up the job. As simple as that. Because anything goes wrong, then you'll be subject to this one. Rule number, this one is under conduct of registered valuer. You tak cukup, this is under section under rules number 33. Eh? If you're not sure, then you don't take up the job. If you take up the job and then you are a problem to you and the client is not happy, the client can then submit a complaint to the board and then you will go undergo all those CMC, CIC yang kita dah go through with your colleagues last week. Masih ingat lagi? You will be subject to the disciplinary action. Alright? Okay. Ada soalan lagi yang lain? So, ada soalan setakat ni? Ada soalan? Any question? Right? So kalau kita jadi valuer and you are also an estate agent for the seller, can you do the valuation job for the buyer? If you are registered valuer but you act an estate agent for the seller, can you do the valuation report for the buyer? Boleh tak?
Yeah. Boleh? Conflict of interest.
Conflict of interest. Yes, you must observe this one. Because this is provided under Rule 64. Eh? Right? Blair, are you with me? Under Rule 64. Okay. Rule 64 talk about registered valuer or appraiser acting as an estate agent. Registered valuer or appraiser who acts as an estate agent for the vendor, for the owner of a transaction should not eventually value the property concerned for the purchaser. I have simplified this one. Registered valuer who be appointed as a registered estate agent for the seller, you cannot do the valuation for the buyer. Boleh? Chua? Chua, are you here? Chua, are you here? Chua Tenghua, are you here? Chua? Tak ada dah, dah pergi bisnes mana dah.
Doktor, ulang balik doktor.
Ulang balik.
Tak jelas yang tu.
Okay, if you are a valuer, right? Because valuers can also practice as a registered estate agent. Okay, kata kalau you valuer, kalau certain company dibuat a division clear, you valuer, you buat valuation saja, you don't do estate agency, but estate agent, you do estate agency, you don't do valuation even though you have the qualification. Right? So in this case, kalau you company yang you buat semua, you seorang you boleh buat semua because you have the license, not a problem. You are registered valuer, but at that particular time, you practice as an estate agent. Right? So katakanlah tadi, saya kata Pak Ismail, you are the RV and you are the REA. Masa you buat jadi REA, you act as a seller. Right? You nak jual the seller, the landlord, the owner yang appoint you to sell his property. Sell property to the buyer. Nah, the buyer wants to apa ni apply for bank loan financing purpose. So you cannot do the valuation for the buyer for financing purpose because you have done a job as an estate agent or the owner. Boleh faham? Itu maksudnya.
Doctor, what is the reason behind?
Pardon?
What is the reason behind? So
what is the reason? This,
yeah.
For this purpose. Because we don't, there is a conflict of interest. Because when you sell the property on behalf of the owner, katakanlah you sell for 6 million. And then when the buyer purchase, he need that 6 million. So if you only value 6 million, he will only obtain loan of 85% or 90%. He will not get 100%. Now you want the buyer to purchase a property full loan because you have convinced him to purchase his property. Because you act of as a owner, you act on behalf of the owner, but you convince the buyer to purchase a property at 6 million. And you say, don't worry, you can get 6 million from the bank. So there is a conflict of interest there because you eventually say, I can do the job valuation if it's allowed. So you will not value at 6 million, even though the transaction is at 6 million. Because if you value at 6 million, the buyer will not get 6 million. The buyer will only get 80 of 6 million, 80%, about 5 million. So he has to come up with another balance of 1 million. So if you do the valuation for the buyer, the tendency is, because you want him to purchase at 6 million, you will end up doing a valuation report of not 6 million, but 8 million. So that he can get 6 million from the bank without coming for a deposit from his own pocket money. That's the reason. Boleh faham? So that is a clear abuse of the market value. Because when you do 8 million, that you become 8 million, and then what will happen to the document? Say sign purchase, you sign berapa million? Are you going to sign at 8 million? Tak kan? You're going to sign at 6 million then? Are you going to sign, as the buyer going to sign the purchase price at 6 million? Or he's going to sign at 8 million so that he can get the loan at 8 million? Kalau with the developer, they will sign 8 million. 8 million inclusive of everything, all the freebies semua dekat situ. So that's the reason why, kalau dalam property buyer, mana Chua? Chua, are you here? Chua Tian Wan? Apa lagi yang practice as Sujong? You pun practice as Ren kan?
Yeah.
You pun practice kan?
Yeah.
Okay. If you sell, you sell as a developer or property developer company, or you sell on behalf of as a second party?
An agent company lah.
From?
From agent.
From agent. So the agent is doing from the developer or from a subsidiary?
Both, but mainly on developer.
Project marketing.
For me, mainly on the developer.
Mainly on the developer.
Yeah.
So, let's share the story. You don't have to mention the developer's name. When you sell on behalf of the developer, did you sell just the physical frame of the structure of a double story semi-detached or double story detached? Or you sell it with free SMP, free aircon, free kitchen cabinet? Okay, jawab Sujong.
Apa? The things, tengok developer lah, dia ada bagi.
Okay lah, so ada tak cases when you sell with the developer will give free stamp duty?
Ya.
Ada kan?
Ada.
Ataupun free built-in cabinet, ada kan?
Ada.
Ada. Free parking pun ada. So yeah. All those free is packaged dalam you punya sales price. Sales price katakanlah how much do you sell? Katakanlah satu, where's the location of your property? Bagi contoh saja. Tujuh?
I think PJ.
PJ. How much is the property?
How much I think up to.
Bagi sajalah yang you tak jual. We wouldn't know. Minute. I'm not going to inform the board, don't worry.
1 million. Oh, 1 million.
1 million. 4 million. Tak dengar.
1 1 1.
1 million. One million would tendency be just like a condominium.
Yeah, condominium.
Yeah. Condominium 1 million. So free SMP. Siapa pay SMP? Siapa pay the stamp duty? Who will pay the stamp duty kalau ikut law?
The buyer.
Who needs to pay the stamp duty? The buyer kan? So now the developer, as a property owner, absorb the buyer. Ya, betul lah, you, Kayun. Siapa tadi? Brian, you. Ah, betul ni, Kai. Mana dah cuar pergi? Lain tak betul lah, tak pergi jual property lagi. Yelah, cuar. Betul ke cuar? Nobody trust you, cuar. Cuar and his property manager. Okay, dekat sini. Sri Jones tadi cakap 1 million property. 1 million property and the property owner as a developer will then package 3 SMP. By right, the SMP is going to be paid, is supposed to be paid by the buyer. Now he absorb. It's 1 million, now he has to absorb stamp duty. Katakanlah stamp duty 2%. Dah jadi 200,000. So now the property is not 1 million, it's actually 1.8 million. Betul kan? Betul, Sri Jones?
Yeah.
Okay, now, in addition to that, dia ada lagi free package. Free package yang dia kata free aircon for the four bedroom, free lagi you punya parking lot, free you punya built-in cabinets and wardrobe. So, it come another 100,000. Katakanlah 100,000. Tak sampai 200,000, 50,000. Tapi with the parking lot, may come up to 100,000. So actually the property at the end of the day, when you deduct all those free, the property value is only about 700,000. But they have sold to you at 1 million. So in the market, as far as market is concerned, the property, the transaction took place at 1 million. The fee be semua tu dah jadi macam package kat situ. So this will then be a distorted to the market. Inilah yang jadi value, jadi kelangkaput. Sebab nanti you kata 1 million, but actually not 1 million. Sebab tu dia kata, sebab itu dia tak nak nanti you buat valuation pula untuk the buyer 1 million. Ini dalam kes yang 1 million, you do valuation report 1 million. But the transaction actually took place only 700,000. So that's the reason why as a registered valuer who act an estate agent, you cannot do the valuation report for the buyer. Because you want the buyer to, you want the transaction to go through and you convince the buyer you can get the loan for that amount of the actual, the total amount of the transaction price. Because if you submit to the bank loan at 1 million, you will not get 1 million as a financing. Unless this is your first time home buyers. Dapat ke 1 million kalau sujung? Can you get 1 million? 1 million boleh dapat full loan ke?
Normally 90% lah.
90% saja. Right? So that's the reason why the Act do not allow registered valuer who act an estate agent for the seller to do the valuation report for the buyer. For the buyer.
But okay. Doctor, you can call your friend in the same firm to help you.
Can you do it in the same firm?
No, I think.
No,
tak boleh. Not in the same firm because you are representing an entity, bukan yourself sahaja. Dia macam form satu rumah lah. You jual abang dengan adik. Boleh tak? Kayun. Mingkai. Okay, Kayun. Boleh tak?
Cannot.
Itulah ada reason dia. Okay. If you can move. If registered valuer has acted for the effort of a seller, no other registered valuer in the same firm can be involved in the same transaction. Itu jawab soalan ni tadi. Kayun. Boleh? Boleh Kayun, this is under rule 64, okay. From the same firm also tak boleh. Right, so you must disclose your personal interest and no payment commission to any person that introduce clients pun tak boleh. No profit sharing connection of professional work. You tak boleh profit sharing as far as professional work is concerned as a value work. Right, boleh? Ada soalan? Itu dalam rule 64 and 65. Right. So if you can move, kita dah sampai 10 dah. Okay, last slide. So the banyak lagi sebenarnya as far as the code of conduct of practice is concerned, shall not accept professional work on his account and cannot be employed in other company. Right, so you cannot do personal case basis. You cannot go to you as a person. It has to be on as a firm. Go back to the basic tadi. You cannot practice on your individual personal capacity. It has to be done as a firm. Kita ada berapa firm tadi yang you boleh consider to practice? Lingkai?
Ah, hello. Ah, yes.
Ah, ada berapa jenis firm yang you boleh consider to practice? Kalau dia buat halo-halo tu, you okay je?
Oh.
How many firm that you can consider to practice? Okay.
Empat.
Cakap je lah.
Ah.
Amirul, ada berapa jenis firm yang kita boleh consider to practice? Amirul, are you here? Amirul, Alia, ada berapa jenis firm yang we can consider to practice? Dah hilang dah pula.
Firm of practice ke? 8 kan?
8? Kita kata firm.
4.
Kita kata registered valuer, working and non-valuation firm shall not have valuation firm. But shall not have valuation. Betul ke ni? Bukan shall not have valuation firm ni. Shall not have valuation job ni. Oh, bukan. Bukan. Ni yang saya cakap yang tadi. Shall not practice. We are still here. Shall not accept. Oh, shouldn't be one. Saya selalu tak buat. Okay, bullet number one. Shall not accept professional work on his account and can. You cannot practice on your personal capacity. Saya tanya, how many types of firm can you consider?
Doctor, we are losing you.
Huh?
Can you repeat that? You were stuck just now.
You were stuck. Okay, I'm at the bullet number one, Lavinia. Shall not accept professional work on his account. I mean, you cannot accept on as a individual capacity. It has to be on firm basis. Boleh? You cannot work as a firm. You cannot be on individual capacity. Boleh dengar yang itu?
Tak boleh kerja seorang-seorang lah.
Boleh.
Okay. So, how many firms can you consider to work, to practice?
Three.
How many types of firms?
Three.
Apa dia?
Sole proprietorship, partnership, and the company. I can't remember the name.
Company. Itu saja, tiga saja. Yang you boleh consider. But if you are an employee, means you are registered value, but you are employee of this three practice, you cannot accept on your own capacity. Maksudnya you tak boleh buat sign on your own. It has to be under a firm. Itu maksud dia kat situ. Boleh faham? And then, if registered valuer acts as an estate agency for the seller, no other registered firm valuer in the same company involved in the same transaction. Kita dah go through yang tadi. Oh, saya dekat salah. Kita dekat sini. Shall not accept professional work on his account, cannot be employed in other company. Must not be employee in activities other than valuation work unless approved by the board. Maknanya, if you are a registered valuer, if you do other job other than valuation work, you must have the approval by the board. Katakanlah you work as a valuation, you practice as a registered valuer. You boleh practice as a registered estate agent if you have your license. You boleh practice as a registered property manager. That one is all approval by the board. Let's say you want to practice as yang lain pula. Apa lagi yang you can practice? Katakanlah you want to practice as a apa yang berkaitan dengan profit valuation firm. You want to have another firm that you provide like apa yang kita cakap, the organizer untuk wedding ceremony tu, event management. Can you work as an event management? Towards weekend you nak jadi event manager. Boleh tak? Kalau bot bagi dan you boleh. Kalau bot tak luluskan, you tak boleh. Because you boleh jadi event manager but you cannot put your name bot. Event manager nama you loving you bawah sudah. Registered value of V number tak boleh. Macam gitu. Because you will conflict yourself as a professional. But you may be approved by the board to have a company doing event manager. It can be done as long as the board is made known and as long as you get the approval by the board. Boleh faham?
So if you have like your own business at the side, does that also need to be approved?
As long as it is not another professional body.
Okay.
Professional, satu saja. event manager is not a professional body.
How about lecturer?
Lecturer is not a professional. You can work as a lecturer. I can have my firm, but I cannot have a sole proprietor. I can work as a managing director of another firm. Dr. Rosi Faiz is practicing as a managing director of another firm. Dr. Anwar, sorry, Professor Anwar is also practice as an attorney. It's not a problem. Dr. Zai also practice. They can practice, but they must make known, get the approval by the board. So lecturers can practice with a company as long as they don't hold a firm as a sole proprietor. They can become partners. They can have a firm, but the firm must be a partner, partnership, or a fully corporate. Boleh? Can we move? So valuation shall not have valuation firm. So valuation report must comply the standard. This is by the MV, kena ikut market value, Malaysian valuation standard kena ikut. Only the resident registered valuer can hit the branch office unless allowed by the board. Only resident. When we say resident means, kalau you work as a lecturer and you have a become a partner, can you open your branch office dekat Penang? Kuantan lah dekat sikit. Boleh tak? Agak-agaknya. Can I have, I'm a registered valuer. I am a registered valuer. And now would like to become a partner with my colleagues who have, who said he needs an office, a registered valuer dekat Kuantan. Can I be a resident registered valuer dekat Kuantan while become a full-time lecturer? Can I?
Boleh.
Yeah?
Boleh.
Kuantan boleh. What is, when the word resident, apa maksud dia agak-agaknya? Resident means?
Means you stay
there. Ha, resident duduk situ kan, panggil penduduk tu panggil resident. You must stay there. You must stay there means, kalau untuk registered value, you must show proof that you have a house to rent, you ada bayar rental, atau you bayar your bill electric, bill air, under your name. Electricity bill, utilities bill under your name. So that show proof that you are a resident registered valuer. But if you are a full-time lecturer, then you will not get the approval by the board because you are a full-time lecturer in University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur. Unless you are a registered valuer with a university, let's say UITM Kuantan, if they have your UMP, University Malaysia Pahang, if they have the if you're a registered valuer and you work with University of Malaysia Pahang, you can have your office there dekat Kuantan on a partnership basis, not a problem. But you cannot stay full time here in KL and then you work somewhere else outside of KL. Itu yang dia tak benarkan. Right? So last one, registered valuer who is sole proprietor, partner or director of a firm shall be held jointly and liable for any non-compliance of the act. Kalau salah, semua kena carry the responsibility. Dia takkan jadi to the person saja. It has to carry a name as a company. Sebab you tak boleh practice on individual capacity. You can only practice on the apa basis? Kira? Kira?
Yeah.
You boleh practice? Can you practice on individual capacity?
Boleh yang sole proprietor? Tapi
kita
ada
supervision. Okay. Lah. Tapi kalau ada salah, you will not
be okay.
Kalau salah dia tak pergi kepada you seorang saja, dia pergi kepada you and your firm.
Firm.
Firm lain, firm entity lain, personal capacity lain. Right? Boleh faham? So anything goes wrong, it will not be just be you yourself, but everybody kalau dalam case partners or the company. Atau dalam sole proprietor, dia akan pergi dua sekali. To you as a person and to your company. It will not be to you as a person saja. Kalau you ada non-compliance of the act and rules. Boleh faham? Boleh?
Boleh.
Right. So kita dah come to the end of your lecture. Besok kita nak start kelas pukul?
10.
10. Salah tau tak?
Doktor, the attendance and spectrum is not available.
Kepala sekarang ni dah faham dia kan? Dah, labin dia.
Oh, tak payah key in dekat.
Oh, you alamak, sebab hari tu, sebab last week was made known that spectrum ada problem. So ada yang tak boleh attend. So saya buka balik. Okay, but saya boleh buka.
Doktor, saya datang tadi.
Ya?
Tadi doktor panggil, saya ada meeting dengan Dr. Aino.
Syahira ada tadi, ya?
Saya
tak panggil nama you tadi. Siapa yang tak ada lagi? Basan, are you here? Basan yang tak ada. Yang lain semua dah ada. Okay, Syahira yang tak ada tadi. You at 10 and please regulate the professional conduct ethics, and saya akan bagi lagi group yang belum buat lagi untuk preparation kalau sempat esok masa macam tak sempat lah. Untuk focus on valuer sahaja. Sebab besok kita ada to prescribe scale of fees by group Lavinia, Wahida and Amira. And then kita ada to regulate the professional conduct ethics ini. You may relate this to the conduct, tapi kita ada tiga sekali, valuers, appraiser, estate agent and property manager. Saya tak tahu. Afiq is one. You buat. Izzat. Afiq, you buat semua. All the three profession ke?
Property management tak ada. Sebab kita orang pakai buku yang lama.
Okay, so untuk dia ada dua saja, valuers and estate agent saja.
Yeah.
Okay, and then okay, so besok kita akan pergi dua. In the role of registered valuer, appraiser, estate agent, ini tak ada masalah. Kaini, Sujong, ada eh? You dah siap yang ni eh?
Yeah.
Okay, so I see you tomorrow at 10. So in the meantime, saya akan, okay, saya akan buka structure nantilah kalau nak, kalau boleh buka. Sebab last week, our head of department mentioned that kalau boleh jangan pakai structure dulu. It's fine. Okay, I'm going to stop it now, your recording. So I see you besok pukul 10 pagi. 10 pagi. Boleh?
Boleh.
Alright. Thank you. Bye. Assalamualaikum.
Bye.
Thank you,
Prof. Thank you, Prof.